Well, the way in which I want to address Project Civil City is to actually look at the framework document, the way it was laid out, the explanation of the rationale for it, and some of the very many ideas that it contains. So let's start with the four primary goals. Eliminate homelessness. Eliminate the open drug market on Vancouver's streets. Eliminate the incidence of aggressive panhandling. And increase the level of public satisfaction with the city's handling of public nuisance and annoyance complaints. All of these with a benchmark of reducing them by 50% at least by 2010. Well, from my point of view, so far so good. Perhaps we're headed in the right direction. And then they follow with 10 immediate actions that they think will get the thing rolling and establish committees, get some people in place and move on it. And establish benchmarks. One of the things I like about this is they say, well, let's establish where we are now so that when comes a few years' time, we're going to be able to report out and say, tell you, the public, how well have we been doing? Another thing I like about Project Civil City, it's not just the city involved. They've gone out and recruited federal ministers and provincial ministers so that, in fact, there's going to be less opportunity to pass the buck. One of the areas that I'm a little concerned about is reconfiguring the Four Pillars Coalition to deal mainly with public disorder. You know, the Four Pillars theory in itself of dealing with prevention, with dealing with treatment, dealing with enforcement, and dealing with harm reduction, a very good theory. But here we are some 9 years or something into the process. And how far have we come? We maybe got a little bit of progress in two pillars and nothing anywhere else. So I think that one of the things we might do in reflecting back is to look at what happened and what didn't happen and why. Let's get better drug treatment. Let's, if appropriate, reinstitutionalize the severely mentally ill. There's a lot of people who were turned loose, wound up in the downtown east side. They don't deserve to be there. They shouldn't be there. They're victims. And a lot of people down there prey on them. This is something we should really look at and say, if at least if they were still somewhere where they got good treatment, they got food, they got shelter over their head, maybe this should be something voluntarily. But I think that's something, for example, that's worthwhile having a look at. So there's another idea out of Project Civil City that I think is something that's worth exploring. The homeless thing, I think, is something that offers a fair degree of promise. We've already seen the provincial government announced a $100 million program, which includes not only buying and thereby ensuring they're not going to get knocked down a lot of SROs, but we've also got three social housing projects that are going to be constructed with using provincial government money. And it provides a whole variety of things, pick and choose, and almost a smorgasbord of things that we as individuals and the city government and the senior levels of government can follow to try and make a difference in the city. Thank you.
Reading through this document, it's, as my colleague Nick Volmio here described, it's the dog's breakfast. It's about everything that they could possibly think of, it seems, that might make a city more livable is included in this document. And I think, for me, in reading the document, there's a tension between the amount of the number of initiatives meant to address the topic that Andrew doesn't want us to talk about, homelessness, which I think is well taken, but also the number of initiatives that deal with the ways in which disorder might be criminalized, the ways that various bylaws that might be passed that might give the police, we have more police on the streets enforcing more laws in order to reduce instances of disorder and crime. And I think there's a tension there between initiatives that are fundamentally about social service provision and recognizing that we're all in this together and we all have an obligation to each other, including ensuring that everybody is treated humanely, and mobilizing the criminal justice apparatus in whatever form as a way to punish people and to make distinctions between those of us who are orderly and those of us who are disorderly. And those two key prongs of the report, as I read it, lie in some uneasy tension with one another. The report seems to think that they can be brought together seamlessly. I'm not so certain that that's going to be the case.
Our next speaker is Michael Vaughan from she's the policy director at the BC Civil Liberties Association. Michael is a lawyer and an adjunct professor of law at the University of British Columbia, where she teaches a course on civil liberties. In addition, she's a member of the advisory board of Privacy International and is a frequent speaker on various topics relating to privacy and security. So please welcome Michael Vaughan.
Thank you. Well, certainly the idea of alleviating homelessness is uncontroversial. Let me try to stir up some controversy here. One is the enforcement of current bylaws and possible creation of new bylaws. I disagree with Dave that that's a minor point of this project. That is, we are not going to enforce our no-spitting bylaws against our routinely spitting but money-spending tourist marathoners. Of course we're not. No more are we going to do that than we are going to use our safe streets provisions against soliciting in certain public places against brownies selling cookies or war veterans selling their poppies. It's not going to happen. These laws are not about behavior. They are about certain groups of people. Whether or not these kind of bylaws are meant to be enforced in this discriminatory matter is besides the point. The fact is, that is obviously what happens. Antiquated no-spitting bylaws were originally not about civility. They were about TB. Regardless, what these bylaws now provide is a tremendous tool for potential displacement. People like the public poor, displaced like to another part of town, on the threat of being ticketed or fined or jailed for not paying the fines. And any student of the Olympics would expect this to happen at about this juncture. New bylaws or reinvigorating the enforcement of old bylaws are a standard part of cities experiencing an Olympics cleanup package. At any rate, I don't think it takes a legally trained mind to understand the potential for the injustice of these kinds of bylaws. How you can fine someone $100 for the indignity of having to defecate in a public place and then suggest that this is part of helping them make good choices, where the choice comes into this project is fantastic to my mind. I have heard the notion that, in fact, most of the public urination is, in fact, recreational urination, that these are yahoos, and, in fact, not people who would have to need to do this because apparently we have facilities for those people. None of this adds up to any of the poverty advocates that I'm aware of who work and live this reality. So don't even get me started on the no-sit, no-lie bylaws that have a potential under this particular proposal. I just want to make that point about the displacement potential of bylaws. Thanks.
Clearly, people would like it if increased police would lead to decreased crime. Unfortunately, that's typically not the case. Adding patrol officers to a particular area does not necessarily lead to reductions in crime. It's only if it's incredibly intensive on a particular very small locale will you see a reduction in crime at a particular place. And unfortunately, much of that crime will merely be displaced to another location. So the sad reality is that the police, as much as we'd like to think they can, actually can't do all that much to reduce crime. And I think Cheryl is right that in many instances, the police aren't necessarily arresting poor people. They're isolating behaviors. But as Michael suggested, some behaviors performed by certain individuals are unlikely to attract police attention. The same behaviors performed by other individuals will attract the police's attention. And so oftentimes behavior and status become merged on the street when the police are actually encountering individuals in public space. And I entirely agree with Cheryl that fear is not something to be merely ignored or to be rendered simply as a substitute for something else. Many people are genuinely afraid in the environments in which they live, and ideally they wouldn't be afraid. But simply adding more police may reduce their sense of fear, but it will not actually reduce their vulnerability to crime, and those are not the same thing. And so many of the things that are in Project Civil City are designed to reassure people, but when the rubber meets the road, they may not actually deliver on the promise that we'd like for them to.